4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Okay. Now, the next mudra we do is Surya Mudra. Does anyone know what Surya means? You can unmute yourself and speak.
Sun. Sun. Sun.
Yes. Wow, you all know it. I thought you won't be knowing it. Nice.
Sun.
So, Surya means sun. So, why this mudra is known as the Sun Mudra? Think. And if you have an answer, unmute yourself.
Because
why this mudra is known as the Sun Mudra? Yes.
It'll make you bright.
Okay. Good. Who was it?
Swasti.
Oh, nice. Good answer. Anyone else? Anyone else? Okay. Yes, yes, yes. Someone wants to speak.
It heats up our body.
Okay.
It helps up its sun. Eyes like the sun.
Sorry?
It gives up energy.
Okay, gives energy.
Energy.
Okay, energy.
It helps us wise.
Oh, wow. Superb answer. Adish it was, right?
It helps us get wise.
It helps us stay wise. Wow. Beautiful answers I'm getting from you all. So first, let's practice this mudra and I'll tell you all the benefits of this mudra, okay? So how is this mudra done? The same position you're sitting in, okay, either Sukhasana, Vajrasana, whatever position you're comfortable, back should be straight and your, since it's Hasta Mudra, what we do is thumb and the ring finger. The ring finger and the thumb. So you bend the ring finger and put the thumb on this. So the tip will not be touching. This, the soft portion of the thumb will be touching the ring finger here. Okay, can everybody see? Yes. Yeah, good. Good, nice. So this we keep on the knees. Oops, nice. Keep on your knees. Keep, yeah, both the hands on your knees. Stay still. Okay. Close your eyes, everyone. Yes, and try to focus on your breathing. Whatever thoughts are coming to you, just let them go. Don't think about them. Yes, we just count till 10 and then I'll tell you the benefits of this Surya Mudra. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Okay, open your eyes, everyone. Relax your fingers. Okay. So, benefits of Surya Mudra, as someone said, the sun is bright, so it helps us make ourselves bright. That is true. So, it helps you with the enlightenment. So, many of the Rishi Munis, if you have heard their stories, you must have heard that at the last they attain enlightenment or moksha. So, not moksha in true sense now. Obviously, they attained moksha in true sense, the enlightenment in true sense. But for us, enlightenment will be in the sense, we'll be thinking about something or we'll be stressed about something. And when we do this mudra, we'll be quite relaxed, we'll be quite peaceful. So that kind of enlightenment we'll have. Also, this mudra helps to reduce obesity. And the sun is so bright, so it gives us energy. Someone also mentioned it gives us energy. So that is true. This mudra increases your energy levels. So when you feel weak.
Hi. Can you do it one more time, the Surya Mudra?
Okay, sure, we'll do it. Sure. So when we feel weak, especially when we are not well, down with fever or something, After recovery, a little recovery, you can practice the Surya Mudra and you will feel a lot of energy in your body. So let's practice it again. Surya Mudra, thumb and the ring finger. So we bend the ring finger like this, and the soft portion of the thumb will be on the ring finger. The tips will, it is not like this, the tips won't be touching. It is like this. The soft portion of the thumb will be on the ring finger. Okay, and both the hands on the knees. Close your eyes. Good. Close your eyes, everyone. And till the count of 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Open your eyes, relax your fingers. Whenever you're doing this mudras, try and stay still. That will help you a lot for your concentration also. Okay, now the third mudra. Third mudra is known as the Prithvi mudra. So again, a question from me to you all. What does Prithvi mean?
Earth.
Okay, good. Yes, Prithvi mudra. In Sanskrit and in Hindi, Prithvi means earth. So how is this mudra done? Same like Surya Mudra, the ring and the thumb fingers are involved. But here you need to join the tips and all the other three fingers will be straight. Yes, this is the Prithvi Mudra. And you keep your hand on your knees like this and practice this mudra. Okay, so we'll first practice this mudra and then see what are the benefits of this mudra. Okay, everyone, choose a good position and stay still in that position. Yeah, not moving much. And the hands will be in this position. On the knees, close your eyes. Yes, close your eyes, everyone. Concentrate on your breathing. Concentrate. Yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Open your eyes and relax your fingers. Good. So, okay, again a question. So, how does Prithvi Mudra help us? Try an answer.
Maybe it helps make us strong because, like, the earth is strong. So, maybe it helps make us strong.
That's a very good guess. Anyone else?
It helps us be grounded, like, stay like down, will come.
Oh, wow. Super. I think
it makes us more connected to the nature.
Good. Who's this?
Shreya.
Oh, nice.
I think it makes us truthful.
Stress-free.
No, truthful.
Truthful. Okay. Okay.
Eyesight increases.
Okay.
Can you show me the hand postures again?
The?
Can you show me the Prithvi?
Prithvi Mudra again. Sure. We'll do it again. Yes.
Makes you feel happiness.
Happiness. Wow. Actually, all of these answers are right. So, like someone said, you know, it helps us to stay calm. So obviously, this Prithvi Mudra keeps you happy and peaceful. Somebody also said happiness and calm and strong like the earth. So it helps you increase your tolerance levels. So at times, you know, when your friends are doing something wrong with you, or you feel that this person is plotting something against you, or whatever, something like that, and you feel angry. But when you do this mudra, This will really help you stay calm. Okay. Also, one very important thing is Prithvi Mudra. It helps you when you have deficiency of vitamins. Yes. It helps you a lot when you have deficiency of vitamins. Okay. So, let's do the Prithvi Mudra again. A good position. Yes. Stay still. Again, the thumb and the ring finger just join the tips. All the three fingers straight and keep it on your knees. Yes, keep it on your knees. And close your eyes. Stay still for 10 seconds. Close your eyes. Stay still for 10 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Open your eyes and relax your fingers. Yes. Okay. Last mudra is Mahaprana Mudra. You have heard Mahaprana, right? This word you have heard. What does this mean?
It's one of the two great poems, Mahabharata and Ramayana.
And?
It's a poem.
Okay. Anything else?
Mama makes her voice sweet.
Oh, your voice is really sweet. Good, good, good. So, this Mahaprana Mudra, it helps you, it improves your eyesight. So, if anybody, like if someone has spectacles here, they're wearing spectacles, try and do. I'll be teaching you Mahaprana Mudra now. So, we'll do this Mahaprana Mudra. But you try it every day, at least for 5 minutes, and see the improvement in your eyesight. Okay. Also, when you have weakness in the body, and if you practice this Mahaprana Mudra, you will feel very lively, very energetic, and also improves your immunity power. So I would say this is the best mudra you should practice. Every one of us should practice, especially in this corona times. The immunity power is something which we all should improve. So I would suggest you all at least do this mudra daily. It is very, very beneficial, and do teach your parents also this mudra. So in this mudra, thumb, the ring finger and the little finger. All the three fingers, both the fingers and the thumb we need to take and just join the tips like this. All the two fingers will be straight. Okay. Not like this, but straight. And now keep it on your knee, both the hands on your knee. Close your eyes, concentrate on your breathing. Stay still for 10 seconds, don't move at all. Don't move. And when the thoughts are coming to you, just wave the thoughts away and try to concentrate on your breathing. And try to say to yourself that I am getting energy, I'm getting strength, I'm becoming strong, I'm healthy. Stay still for 10 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Open your eyes slowly and relax your fingers. Okay, so now this will be a question session for the next 2 minutes. Okay, so should I call out names or you will be raising your hands up and then answering? Should I call out names? And if you want me to call out names, raise your hands. Okay, I don't think so. Many of you want. Fine. So whenever I ask a question, whoever knows the answer can unmute and speak. But raise your hand and then unmute yourself. Okay. So can someone show me the Prithvi Mudra? Avni?
you put your hands like this.
Okay.
Touching with your thumb. And then you put your hands on your knees. And then you close your eyes for 10 seconds with your back straight.
Good, good, good. Okay. And the next will be Surya Mudra. Swasti.
So you go in a comfortable position and you put your fingers and you put your ring finger over here and you connect them.
Okay.
And then you close your eyes and you focus on your breath.
Good. Nice, nice. Okay. Surya Mudra. Adish.
You keep your hands like this.
Okay.
Then you hold it back straight for 10 seconds.
Nice. Okay. And the last, Mahaprana Mudra. Shreya.
So you put your ring finger and the small finger on your thumb like this and then put it on your knee.
Right. So you need to join your tips. Right, right. Perfect. Good. So I guess many of you remember all the mudras. So I would suggest that all of you please try and do these mudras. It will be very beneficial for you, all of you. And Mahaprana Mudra is a must. At least for 5 minutes, try and sit still, no movement at all, and practice this Mahaprana Mudra every day for 5 minutes. And you will see wonders working for you. I'm very sure. Okay. Yes, I guess we need to end this session here.
Right. Okay. Does anyone have any question? Let me see the chat. Right. Okay, I don't see any questions in the chat either. So we will move on to the next session. The next session is from respected Samniji, Shanti Pragyaji. Samniji, I request you to start your lecture. Vandami Samniji.
Vandami Naman Sami.
You can stay on. You can stay on if you want to.
I have another session now.
No problem.
The younger kids.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, thank you very much.
Vandami
Naman Swami.
Vandami Naman Swami.
Vandami Naman Swami.
Vandami Naman Swami.
Vandami Naman Swami.
Vandami Naman Swami.
Vandami Naman Swami.
How are you all?
Vandami Naman Swami. What is this? Have questions. I'm just
I'm
Hello.
आराध्य के चरण में वंदन, परम पूज्य गुरुदेव के चरण में वंदन। डियर किड्स, सो टुडेज आवर टॉपिक इज व्हाई आर यू हियर। ओके, व्हाई आर यू हियर। Do you have any idea? Why are you here?
Because of our karmas.
Because of your karmas. Okay. Any other response?
Because of your naam and gotra and Ayusha karma from the last birth.
Okay. I think now kids are... You all have more information about Jainism, but I'm asking in general, whenever you go, you can ask this, anybody can ask you question. Why
are you here?
Right? So for today's camp also, I'm asking you, why are you here?
For our learning skills.
Learning skills. Okay. Okay. I will start my session with story. Okay. Do you like story?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, when I ask, you can unmute yourself. Otherwise, you can listen to me. Okay. Please keep muted yourself. So once there was a man who was a true devotee of God, right? And he was always dedicated towards his devotion, as his devotion of duty was always loyal. Now God decided to bless him. God asked him that, what you want? God asked his wish, so God can fulfill it. God comes to you, what will you ask? Do you want anything from God?
I would ask who I was in the last birth and why am I here?
Okay. Any other response? What do you want from God? From, like, if you ask God for jewelry, he can give jewelry. Can give gems, he can give anything you want. So what for what you can ask? What
I would ask for the path for moksha and yeah.
Okay. Any other?
For a peaceful life.
You don't have any other desire? You don't want any things? Like some of you can have desire that in future I want the car or bungalow, like a largest bungalow of my city, or costliest car of this world, or I want to be a richest person of this world, like this, no? You don't have any like this anything of like this, any desire of like this? No? Because God can give anything. When God comes to you and when he asks that you can ask him for anything, then he can give. Then what will you ask him?
I would ask for... Which God?
God means Dev.
Oh, Dev.
Yeah. So they can give prosperity and luxurious life and all that things.
Oh, then I would ask him to make him go to Simandir Swami. And then when I go to Simandir Swami, I'm going to ask him about like 500 billion things.
Okay. Okay. Any other? Kia? Who is Kia? I don't know. Can you share your views? Kaya. No? Okay. Yuhan. Do you want to share your views? Yuhan. Yuhan. What is name? Yuhan maybe. No. Yeah, who is? Okay.
So,
when God asked,
Please pardon the question. My sound was low, so I could not listen the whole question.
Yeah, if God comes to you, God means Devati, Dev, comes to you and he asks you that you can ask anything if you want anything. Then what will you ask for them? For what you will ask him? That I want this, this and that. You got my question? Did you get? No? Okay, then when God asked the devotee, maybe he was also like you and he told, like he replied to God that I'm satisfied with whatever I have. I don't want anything. I don't need anything. But God wanted to bless him and told him that you have to ask something. You have to ask for something. Because a meeting with a God cannot go in vain. So devotee thought a while and then asked for a rose plant. God asked him, why rose, only rose plant? You can ask for something valuable like money, gold, diamonds, jewelry, palace, luxury, etc. But why only rose plant? And devotee replied, no, I want only the rose plant. But why only rose plant? And devotee replied, the day it starts blooming, the beauty and fragrance of rose it spreads all over, and even when it is padded in the soil, the fragrance never dies, right? So it fulfills purpose of its life. So this plant will remind me again and again, what do you do in my life? What is the purpose of my life? Why am I here on this earth, in this world? So my question was also you. For you, that why are you here? It's not for only for this camp. This question comes to us many times. When we go to school, what happens? What happens? Teacher asks us, right? That why are you here? And what our question was? To study. We are here to study. Okay, today also I asked you that why are you here in this camp? Your reply was to gain new knowledge, new skills, to attain new skills of knowledge, right? So in and further, when you grew up, you will grow up and you will go to college. There also your professors
Your teachers will ask you that why are you here, and you will reply that for degree, right? Then you will go to job or workplace. They will ask you that why are you here, and your reply will be to earn money. But did you get any clue? Did you get any clue? Behind every action of ours, there has to be a reason. And above are the few examples. But still the question arises, why are we here? If we don't know, it will happen with us. What happens with many of the people of this world? Do you know that most of people have regrets on their deathbeds? And in those regret,
regret.
Yeah, like what is regret? What is regret according to you?
Let's say it's when you feel that you did the wrong thing before.
Yeah, right.
You have done a mistake.
Yeah.
Such as
most of people, when they are going to die, they have regrets. Which type of regrets? That they had regrets that. Sorry. Yeah. I wish I had the courage to lead a life true to myself, not the life others expected of me. I wish I had the courage to live a life with true purpose of my life. Right? So they had this regret. And you can see this writer, or image of this writer, Bonnie Burr. She is an Australian author and songwriter and motivational speaker, best known for her writings. What? The Top 5 Regrets of the Dying. She wrote in her book after her experiences, because she spent years working in palliative care in Australia, looking after patients in the last 3 to 12 weeks of their lives. During that time, she became used to hearing elderly reveal their biggest regrets. And at the top of the list is the biggest regret generally people have on their deathbed. That bed was, I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself, not the life others expected to me. It means if I could live, I would live my life with true purpose of my life, but they didn't do it, so they had regret. So this was the most common regret of all, when people realize that life is almost over and look back clearly on it, it is easy to see for them that how many dreams have gone unfulfilled. Most people had not honored even a half of their dreams and had to die knowing
Hello.
Can anybody hear me?
Okay, yes.
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Hi.
Hi.
Then where is she gone?
Yes, we can hear you, Ruday.
Who told that? Huh?
No one.
Let me find. Come to boys. Who is she? Tell one time again.
Hi.
Hi. Hi.
Got it.
Okay.
Oh my goodness. How many people are chatting?
Did somebody get dropped?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Did Shamini ji drop off? Hello, Mehul bhai.
Yeah, it looks like somebody got dropped. Let me call her. Okay, please bear with me.
Okay. All right. Hi, students. How are you?
Good.
Sir, we are fine.
This is, my name is Kinesh and she is Preeti. We're going to be conducting the next session for you. So once Shamaniji is done, we will talk to you about how to apply Jainism in everyday life.
Okay.
And there's a lot of thinking involved, so get ready. I think Shamini ji is having some computer problem. So,
I just talked to Shamini ji. For some reason, her computer just shut down. So, she's starting it up and she's going to join pretty soon. Sorry for the interruption.
Okay.
All right,
I want to share screen.
So let me make you co-host, Swami ji, JVB Orlando.
Yeah. Sorry. Actually, I don't know what happened. All of a sudden, sign out automatically. Okay. Can you see? Okay, good. So we're asking about the what about regrets of people who are on their deathbed, right? So what happens with them? I was telling about the Bonnie Byrne. She's an Australian author and songwriter, motivational speaker. She has written
Samneji, you can stop annotation.
Sorry?
You can stop people from drawing on the board.
Yeah.
Yes, you can stop the annotation.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. So, Bonnie Byrne, she spent years in working care in Australia, looking after patients in the last 3 to 12 weeks of their lives. Okay? During that time, she became used to hearing the elderly reveal their biggest regrets. At the top of the list of these biggest regrets, generally people have on their deathbed was, I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself, not the life others expected of me. So generally what we do, generally what people do, they are living their life according to others, not according to their purpose. So we should live our life with our purpose. Live a life true to yourself instead of the one other aspect, right? I will not have this regret because I have tried my best to do this all my life, and I have always tried to live a life through myself, especially after initiation, right? Means after Diksha, I'm trying my best to live the life I always wanted to live. I'm practicing my sadhana very well, and also I'm trying to serve the community, the society, the entire world. I also teaching Jainism to others. So I will not have this rigor, but I want to ask you that what do you want? How about you? What will happen? Do you have any purpose in your life or not? So, are you living the life you always want to be? Still, you are very small, but you should start to think about it. Always wanted to live a life true to yourself? Or are you living a life others want you to live? In your school and or anywhere, your friends, they can push you, that they can push you to do mischief. But what are you doing that time? What are you doing that time? Are you ready to do that thing? Or no, you are true to yourself that no, I should not do wrong. I should accept myself what I want to do. I never want to do wrong with anybody. So what? Are you living the life others want you to live? Or are you letting others plan your life? Or are you planning yourself for you? Like your friends will say, no, today you have to do this and this. You are following your friends, or you are judging yourself. What I should do? What are you doing? What are you doing? You. Everybody, can you help to mute people? Okay.
जी समझी जी अभी अभी करता हूँ.
हाँ. So, whenever we find this situation that the other people, they are trying to lead us on the wrong path, they are pushing us on the wrong path. So at that time, what are we doing? Can you just do that? Take your car from your garage and
what is this?
Sorry, Hriday, can you keep yourself muted? So, are you doing like this? Your parents or your, like anybody can do this? Like, take your car from your garage and drive it. Simply pull the car out of garage and start driving. If you have not decided upon your destination, can you get an enjoyable, satisfying journey? No, right? An enjoyable and satisfying journey is impossible if you don't know where you want to go. You should know where you want to go. So, in the same way, we should know what is the purpose of our life, why are we here? Right? Why am I here? Ask yourself, why are you here?
I have a question.
Yeah.
How people, when we are taken from a garage, and we are driving simply, and we didn't watch anything, and then get accident also.
Yeah, it will make accidents and also like where will you go, right? If you don't have any destination, simply you are driving, driving and driving. Where will you go? Very good for that. Okay. Yeah. So we should have destination. So in our life also we have purpose. I think all of you are older than 8 years, right? More than 8 years or older than 8 years. 8 years, 9 years, 10 years old.
Till yes. 30
years, right? So now you should start thinking. You are not too much young. Now you should start thinking that why I'm here? What is the purpose of my life? Right? If we are not thinking about it, we'll be late in our life. We'll be keep ourselves behind all things. Like we'll not get whatever we can get in our life. Whatever we want to achieve in our life. So now you should start. why do I exist? What is the reason for your place in the universe? Life purpose is a destination, and to reach that place, you spend each moment of your life on that path. So what should be purpose? What is the purpose? We can say the purpose, every person has different purpose of their life, because every person is a unique in this universe, right? Each person is unique, from their DNA to fingerprints. It is reasonable to believe that each of us also has a purpose, a reason for being, that is uniquely personal. We need to discover the reason, right? We find each individual having diverse interests. On this basis, people can be categorized as work center. Like some people like work, so they are work center. Some people love their family, so they are family center. Some people love their friends, so they are friend center. And some all want pleasure, so they are pleasure center. And some people are enemy center, some possession center, self-centered, value centered. But we can give many categories like this. So what is a purposeful living, right? So with example, we can understand that what is a purposeful living. What do you want from your parents? If your parents ask on your birthday that I will give the biggest and gift on this your birthday, then what will you ask for? Whatever you want, they will give you. Then what will you ask? Any?
Why are you giving us?
Yes. Your voice is not clear, Rida. Sorry. So, what will you ask for? If you want any teddy bear, any video game, any laptop, or any like this, any you want, like whatever your biggest wish, you can ask and they will fulfill. Okay. And if they gave you, suppose. A person has a wish that he should have a luxurious home filled with very good finest furniture, and there should be everything should be there in that home, like separate room for playing games, separate room for outdoor games, it means whatever you want, you like, everything should be there. And it should be finest furniture, right? If you get that type of home, then would you use it as a warehouse or storeroom? Would you use it as a warehouse or storeroom? Like simply you put your all luggage there. No? It is unlikely that you would misuse the gifts in such a manner. The point being, if we do not use an object in the way it is meant to be used, we are in fact misusing or abusing it. So, in the right same way, if we are not using our life in the right way, it means we are, what we are doing? We are misusing our life. Our life is a great gift for us. So, what should be purpose? So, according to Lord Mahavira, first of all, we'll talk about Lord Mahavira. So according to Lord Mahavira, Bhagavan Mahavir, what should be the purpose of our life? So according to Lord Mahavira, to be free from attachment and aversion in our life, to realize the true nature of self, and to develop universal love and compassion for all living beings is the purpose of our life. So, in this purpose, what is the foundation? What is the foundation of this purpose? The foundation of this purpose is non-violence, equanimity, and the sense of equality for all living organisms on this planet. So, according to Lord Mahavira, the purpose of our life should be to be away from attachment aversion in our life. Okay? So, the next, what is according to Mahatma Gandhi? You have heard that Mahatma Gandhi led India for his independent battle. So, what is according to him? Mahatma Gandhi, he also growing up with Jain religious traditions and a devout mother. He absorbed early on the influence that would play an important role in his adult life, right? So this influences included compassion for sentient beings, vegetarianism, and fasting for self-purification and mutual tolerance, and respect for individuals of different creeds. And the most important thing is Gandhiji never compromised his purpose, whether he was in India or overseas. So, the next, I want to share about Raja Harishchandra, the King Harishchandra. Many of you had maybe heard the story of Raja King Harishchandra. The life of his purpose was always follow the truth, always be truthful. So once what happens, a dev came from the heaven to take a taste of his truthfulness. And what happened for his words, he renounced, he left all his kingdom, because a sage, the dev god came in the form of a sage came as a sannyasi to him, and before he came, he gave a dream to Raja Harishchandra that I'm giving you my old country. Then he came the next morning, that give me your country. You gave it me in a dakshina. And king knew that I had a dream. So he was true to his self, and he gave, or he left his country and gave him. And he suffered a lot, but he was always true to himself. Next, I want to share my views about Acharya Mahapragya. He was a great, great Jain Acharya of this era. He was a great philosopher, great writer, a great preacher, and he wrote around 300 books in his life. So, and he did many works. He also gave the Jain meditation therapy, whatever described in our Agamas, which type of meditation Lord Mahavira did. So he gave all the things. So what was the central purpose of his life? We should know. We should know because it is a guideline for us. So the central purpose of his life was his resolution. He took resolution. First, his resolution was to be a perfect monk. And he always lived like a perfect monk. The second, his resolution was not to hurt his Guru Acharya Tulsi. Third was to serve all mankind. And fourth was not to have any negative thought to harm anyone. So he always firm. He was always firm on his resolution. And really, he lived a life of a perfect monk. He never hurt his guru. He always served all mankind. And he had never negative thought to harm anyone. So these souls lived their life with a purpose and become the models for millions to follow. Right? So it's also important for us that why to discover purpose of life, why we should discover a purpose of our life. I think you got my point, because the purpose of life will deliver immense satisfaction, and purpose of life is to be useful, to be responsible.
Bandaj kariyo. Hey, Swamini ji.
Yeah.
Is he alive today or? Is he called
Who? Acharya Mahapragya?
Yes.
He passed before 10 years.
Oh.
Before 10 years. I am the last Swami of his. He gave last Diksha to me. He is my Diksha Guru. Okay?
Okay.
But you can read his literature. It's very good and very knowledgeable. And we can get solution of everything in his literature. So we should discover our life purpose, right? So we should think that which type of purpose should not be there. So first thing is material possession and pleasure should not be our purpose. That I want this money and luxury and all these things. If money could bring true happiness and long-lasting satisfaction, the wealthiest people in the world would be the happiest one, right? But they are not. So materialistic possession, pleasures and money should be not your purpose. Then not the short-term goals or needs or desires should be your purpose. Like you think that I want to get first rank in my school. It is a short-term goal, or your desires, your needs. It is not your purpose. It is not your purpose of your life. Or the purpose of your life not should be other people. Now some people think that I want to make happy others. It's never possible that you will make happy all the people. It is not possible for anybody. We can make happy some people, not all the people. Okay? So it should be not our purpose of our life, and your status. Never like I want to get the status or this prestige or that. No, it is not your purpose. It should be not your purpose or not any negative feelings like revenge or enmity or violence or jealousy. It should be not your life purpose. Okay, so what should be the purpose on in your life? I think purpose of life is to be useful, to be responsible, to be honorable, to be compassionate. It is after all the matter to count, to stand for something, to have made some difference that you lived at all. It's a very good quotation from Leo Sylvester, right? So while performing any action, we can ask ourselves, okay, okay, what I am doing? You can write these questions. What I am telling you, you can write these questions in your book or anywhere. So what I am doing for my soul, universe, this world and humanity. Okay, the first question is to ask yourself, what am I doing for my soul, universe, this world and humanity? Okay, the second question, am I improving the quality and purity of my true self or am I compromising my true self? Am I improving the quality and purity of myself, my true self, or am I compromising my true self? Okay, so I think many of you have a purpose in your life, decided purpose. So I want to, you can take a blank paper and on the top of a blank sheet of the paper, write what is my true purpose in life. Okay, what is my true purpose in life? And write down any answer that pops into your head. It doesn't have to be a complete sentence, a short phrase is fine. And third thing, repeat the second step. You can do it later also. Record the second step until you write the answer that makes you cry. This is your purpose. For example, in the beginning, you will come up with the bundles of thoughts. Suppose your long-term goal is to become a doctor. Okay, so your first thought will be likely, I want to be a doctor. Okay, ponder this thought further. And next thought, maybe I want to become a compassionate doctor. Then finally, you make your mission statement as I want to live a life of integrity and to serve humanity. Right? So, this is the true purpose of your life, that you want to live a life of integrity and to serve humanity, not become a doctor. Okay? If become a doctor is your purpose of your life, then when you will get the degree of doctor, then your purpose will be finished. No, purpose will never change in your life. So this is your true purpose, driven by the values of compassion, contribution, honesty, and the like. So this is an overarching purpose you will strive to attain in your life. So now you can define your long-term goal, become a doctor. But what will be your purpose? To serve society or humankind in general. So if it happens, sometimes it happens with people or students that they are not getting admission in doctor and they are being they are not getting admission in a medical school, and they are being sad that we are not getting admission. But if your purpose is clear that I want to serve humanity, then you can go in any other field where you can serve the humanity. So what will be the benefit of purposeful life? So first is clarity. You have a clear clarity that what I want to do, and it will drive you smoothly, and you will also get personal growth. You will feel that I'm living meaningful life, and you will be healthier, because purposeful life is a healthy life. Medical research says that the people who have purposeful life, they are being more successful in their life, and also they are more healthier in their life. The research became in 1953. Researchers studying goal setting and surveyed the graduating seniors from Yale University on their goals and purpose and aspiration for the future. They found that only 3% of the graduating class had specific written goals and purpose and objectives for their life. After 20 years, the researchers contacted the same graduates and came up with some very interesting results. They discovered that the same 3% who engaged in the goal setting activity, and they had clearly written their goals and their purpose of their life when they graduated in 1953, were more successful and got more terms of wealth than the other 97% combined. The same 3% also tended to have better health relationships than other 97% of people. So it is good for our health. And when you are living purposeful life, there is a 52% reduced risk of Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so what are the inner and outer purpose? Inner purpose should be realization of inner purpose is important for us, and it is a total success of our life, and it will be permanent. The inner purpose will never change. Yeah, but the short-term goals or goals, the purpose and goals, both are different. We can say different and also same. The goals are the states for purpose. So goals can be changed, but purpose will never change. So the outer purpose is our goals. So it is just a game you can simply play because you will enjoy it, right? And we can also fail there. If you want to be, you want to be a doctor or engineer or any other, we can also fail there. And it is the law of impermanence. But our purpose, if our purpose of life is that we want to serve humanity, it will never change and we will never fail there. So how to stabilize our purpose? So Praksha meditation is a very useful thing for it. And it connects you with your subconscious mind. So first of all, first step of Praksha meditation is resolution. What resolution? That's resolution of practicing meditation to empower the purpose of life. Resolution, the beginning, in the beginning is necessary. Without resolution, we can't be specific that what we want. So when you start meditation, okay, I want all of you to close your eyes for 2 minutes. I will conclude my speech with meditation, and this meditation will be very useful for you for the whole life. So close your eyes softly, sit straight. Hand posture will be Gyan Mudra or Vitarag Mudra. Now we'll take resolution. I am practicing meditation to empower the purpose of my life. I am practicing meditation to empower the purpose of my life. I am practicing meditation to empower the purpose of my life. Now relax your body. Give your suggestion to relaxation. Give your body to suggest your body to relax. Relax, relax, relax. Now concentrate your mind on your breath.
Aren't mind and brain the same thing?
Sorry?
Aren't mind and brain the same thing?
No. Okay, just breathe. Take a deep breath. It helps you to develop focus and remain steadfast on your purpose. Now, visualize your dream, your purpose with closed eye in your mind, with the power of your imagination. The more clearly visualize, the more stable and entrenched your purpose becomes. It should be clear. Your imagination should be clear that this is my purpose in my life. The more concentration you have, the more clearly you visualize. The more clearly you visualize, the more stable and entrenched your purpose becomes. Okay, now feel that you are going towards your purpose. Okay, take 2-3 deep breaths. Conclude the meditation. this will be very useful for you. The practice of practice meditation activates the bright brain and assists you in staying focused. Okay, so when you do all these things, alpha wave is the first requisite to be free from stress by activating the right hemisphere of the brain. The question of wheel was the brain. Brain is there, and mind can go anywhere. Okay, brain cannot go. So I think you got idea that we should have the purpose of our life. The purpose will never change, and the goals can be changed. So you are never too young or old, and you can start today. Okay, all the best. If you have any question, you can ask, or I'll go to the next session.
Thank you very much, Samni ji, Vandami Samni ji. Next, we will have a discourse from Mr. Kinesh Doshi. Mr. Kinesh Doshi and his family, they have been members of JVB Orlando for many, many years. He is a very learned person. He has degrees in B.Tech, M.Tech, and MBA. He owns a software development company. Hundreds of people working for him. And he also has a very keen interest in Jainism and learning Jainism and applying the Jainism principles to the life. That is what he wants to discuss with us today. Kinesh bhai, all yours. I'm going to make you co-host also.
Okay, great. Thank you, Mehul bhai, Jai Jinendra, Nami Shamini ji, and for a very thoughtful presentation. Again, my name is Kinesh. That's my wife, Preeti. And together, like Mehul bhai said, I try to learn Jainism from the modern life's perspective. And I'm going to share some of my thoughts around that. Both the sessions today had a lot of thinking involved. So this one will also require some good thinking from you. What I would suggest is if you can all turn on your video and feel free to interact, feel free to ask questions, because there is a lot of questions here this session. Okay? Let me share my screen now. So what we're going to talk about is applying Jainism in our daily life, right? You all know that Jainism is a very old religion. It's been around for thousands of years. And if you recall all the stories that you hear from Agam and all the stories that you hear, they seem like from a time far, far, far away, right? You think about Chandanbala, you think about, Shalibhadra, and all these stories that you hear, they seem like from a time where the people used to live in villages, they used to go to their farms, they used to eat simple food, and so on. There were no televisions, there was no internet, there was no airplanes, no one traveled across the countries like many of us have done and come to America. So the life was a lot different thousands of years back. And so how many of you believe that Jainism is still relevant? Just say yes if you feel that. Turn on your audio and say yes.
What do you mean? I didn't have a question.
The question is Jainism relevant today? When you play all the video games and watch all the internet and Netflix and fly by planes and all that, do you think Jainism is relevant even today?
Yes.
Most aspects.
Yes.
Most aspects. Very good. Who thinks Jainism is not relevant or at least difficult to apply in today's life?
Mm-hmm.
excuse me.
Yes.
What is the meaning of relevant?
Relevant means can it be applied?
Connection.
Is it connected to our life in the modern life? So we live in a very modern world, right? Is the teachings of Jainism, are they applicable in the new world? That's the question. Okay, no problem.
Yes.
Yes, so all of you believe that it is relevant. Some of you feel that not everything is relevant. Some of you may believe that it's hard to apply in everyday life, right? So what I want to do is today, I want to take some real life examples and have you guys think about, can the principles of Jainism be applied in today's life, right? Before we go there, so we'll do it in two sessions, two components. First, we will first talk about 5 A's of Jainism. That means, what are those 5 A's? And we'll understand them. You guys are really smart. I know that most of you already know what those 5 A's are. So I will not be surprised that you guys already know that. But then in the second part of our session, we will actually take examples and try to see if they apply to our life. Is everyone okay? So you are welcome to talk, welcome to interact on each of this. So well, let's start with what are those 5 A's of Jainism, right? These are not 5 vows. Remember that. We're not talking about 5 vows. We're just talking 5 A's. So let's see. Anyone? What is this?
Ahimsa.
Ahimsa.
It is the most powerful aspect of Jainism. That means non-violence. It means friendship with everyone, right? So it's non-violence with all living beings. Ahimsa is of 3 types, right? One of mind, body, and verbal communication. So it's not just about not hitting anyone. It's also about not saying anything bad. And it's also about not thinking bad about someone else. All these 3 forms of ahimsa one must do. So just remember, in Indian language, himsa means violence. And when you put an a in front of it, on anything in front of that, if you put a, it becomes the reverse, non-violence. Is that clear? Now, interesting thing about ahimsa is that you can't do ahimsa not only on others. Remember, it says all living beings. So what is left with this against others? Are you looking at me, video? It's yourself. So you can't be ahimsa to yourself also. Give me an example when you actually do hinsa to yourself. Anyone?
Suicide.
Yeah, that's a pretty tragic thing. But yes, suicide is very good.
When you put yourself down.
What is that?
When you say bad things about yourself, like I'm so bad at this.
Very good point. Very good example. When you say bad things about yourself, it's also hinsa to yourself. You are not supposed to be a hinsa to yourself also. Any other example anyone can give?
When you doubt yourself.
Yeah, when you don't take care of yourself. Excellent, excellent example. I'm amazed how great examples you guys are giving. If doctor says do this, take this medication, and if you don't take the medication, you are being hinsa to yourself. You are not being non-violent to yourself. Anything else?
When you doubt yourself.
Very good. That's also a hinsa. Absolutely. Anything else?
When you do a himsa to anybody else, it also does a himsa to yourself because you're getting yourself bad karmas.
That is very good. Excellent, Avni. That was a fantastic response. What else?
Like during a test, when you cheat, and then you say like, I think I'm doing the right thing.
That is also true. When you cheat and you feel like you're doing the right thing, you're hurting yourself. That's excellent example as well, Adish. Fantastic. Have you thought about crying? Crying is also hinsa to yourself, right? If you get angry, that's hinsa to yourself because eventually it's hurting you, correct? So I just want to understand.
You can regret it sometimes.
Exactly, exactly. You feel sad. And when you feel sad, you are being hurtful to yourself. So remember, ahimsa is not just for others. It's also for you. And ahimsa is of three types. Mind, body, and communication. Because you can't, not only you can't hurt anyone on yourself, but you can't also say bad things to others and yourself, as well as you don't think bad things about others and yourself. So it was amazing how well you guys gave example of doubting yourself is a hinsa of mind against yourself. So always remember, ahimsa is not just for others, it's also for you. Okay? Let's go on to the next A. Let's see if you guys can guess what this one is.
I have another example for ahimsa.
Okay.
Unself-confidence.
Very good point. Yeah. So if you don't doubt yourself, you're self-confident. And when you're self-confident, you're following non-violence to yourself. Excellent example. Excellent example, Veer. So just keep moving to the second A, guys. We have lots of A's to cover.
That wasn't me. That was Ashwi.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Ashwi, I'm not able to see everyone's name here. So thank you for that. Let's keep going.
Arguing.
What is this? Yes. What are they doing?
Arguing.
Why are they arguing?
Anekantwad.
Very
good. Anekantwad.
Excellent point. It's about
different point of view.
All of you have seen this story, right? Heard about this story? What is this story? Can anyone tell quickly? Yeah.
There
are 11 blind men and the elephant.
Okay. Yeah. So you all know that. Very good. The story is 6 blind men and the elephant, and they all interpret different parts of the elephant differently, right? The one who is touching the tail says it's a rope. The one who is touching the trunk says it's a spear. Right? Remember this story? Everyone knows this story? Say yes loudly. Okay.
Yes.
Very good. So this is an example. You learn this in early part of your life that everyone is right here. Right? Everyone has a point of view, and they are all in some form or shape, they are right. And I was impressed when someone already said that this is Anekantwad. So what is Anekantwad? Anekantwad is for us to look at others' viewpoint and appreciate that, right? You encounter those situations in your classroom, with your friends, with your parents, with your family, your cousins. Don't you encounter that they have a different point of view? And so the idea is to see others' point of view is Anekantwad, right? It's the second A. So everyone knows this, we'll keep moving. If anyone has question, thought, please feel free to throw it.
Aparigraha.
Oh, very close, very good, very close. It's actually an example of Aparigraha also, but it's an example of something else. What is this person doing?
Robbery.
He's doing robbery. He's stealing.
Stealing from a rich person who's crying.
Stealing from anyone is a crime. Even from a rich person is a crime. Right? So what is happening is, this is known as... Okay, let's look at another picture before we come to the name. So this doesn't have to be a crime like you go in jail. But quite a few times, we do crimes every day in everyday life, like someone stealing the cookie from the cookie jar, right? How many times you pick up a chocolate and say, okay, you know what, no one will notice it, let me take it. How many of you have done that? No one is agreeing to it.
A lot of times.
I have done it.
So we all have done it, right? So the idea is that stealing is not just
when people steal money and steal big jewelry and stuff like that. Stealing can happen in everyday life. We can steal from other people or from your own home things. And that's what is known as the third A, which is achorya. So chori, those who know Hindi, means to steal. And remember what I said about Hindi language or Indian language? When you put an A or an A in front of it, what does it become?
Non or the opposite of.
Very good. It's non-stealing. So the idea is to not steal. And steal doesn't mean you go to jail. There are a lot of times in life we do stealing, not realizing that we are actually doing stealing. And we'll give examples of that. We'll soon come to those examples. Let's go to this one. What about this?
Aparigraha.
We see our in our life, our parents, our friends, they want more, more and more, right? You want to shop till you drop, right? What are you looking for? Everything is mine. And you want to gather more, have lots of stuff, have lots of things. So, okay. How about this? Anyone wants to own this yacht and this car?
The Ferrari?
All right. So as you can see, this is all about owning more, having more money. And Shamaniji very nicely explained this thing, right? That the goal of life is not to have, or the purpose of life is not to have lots of money. But a lot of people do what is called as parigraha. Parigraha is to own a lot of things and even be more greedy for more things. And again, remember, if you put a in front of it, it becomes not owning a lot of things.
Opposite
of that. And okay, so the whole idea is, yes, was there a question? Sorry.
Yeah, Bhadra Chakravarti had a Chakravarti and he had everything, but how did he get killed when on his throne? Didn't he have parigraha?
I don't know the story, but you may be right that he had too much parigraha.
No, I think like he had a lot of money, but he didn't want more. Like he wasn't greedy, like, yeah, I have a lot more money, I want more.
Exactly. He was probably born to a lot of money and then he did not want any more. So when you don't want more, you want to live a simple life, that is called aparigraha. Okay?
I thought he wanted to rule all the kingdoms, so all of his brothers took diksha. So he wanted more.
Well, I don't know the story.
But I think I think he didn't care about all of that stuff.
I just love that. So I think that story we'll probably talk about later if that's okay. We'll keep moving because we have a lot of information to cover here, okay? And we have to get to examples. How about this? This is the last A that I want you to think about. What is
Asatya?
This? What was that?
Asatya?
No, I don't have Asatya today. Asatya is actually, we will learn that Asatya is nothing but another form of achorya. And we'll talk about that. That's a great point you made. But we'll talk about that. Asatya is another form of ahimsa or achorya. Anyway, what is this kid doing?
Thinking.
Very nice.
Thinking.
Okay. I think this
thinking.
This will give you the idea. What is this?
Meditating.
Very good. Very good. So Acharya Mahapragya and Acharya Tulsi always talked about what is known as anupreksha. So what you do in anupreksha is you think deeply, you introspect, and you observe yourself. Have you guys observed yourself ever? Do you do that? I know you are 8 years to 13 years, but do you do that? I think you do that. Don't you do that? Don't you think about things that you have done wrong? Once in a while, you sit down and say, you know, I should not have done that. You do that?
Yes.
Right? So even though Shamaniji's have devoted their life to teaching us how to do anupreksha and meditation, I think you all do that. They have a lot of good ideas and techniques to make that effective, but you all once in a while sit down and introspection. So you guys already are master of anupreksha. Okay? All right. Let's move on. So we have talked.
I have a quick question. Does anupreksha count? Does pratikaman fall under anupreksha?
That's a great point. Yes, I would say pratikaman is a kind of anupreksha because you are looking at yourself, you're looking at your sins, and then asking for forgiveness. That's perfect example. Great. Who said that? What's your name?
Diva Kamdar.
Diva Kamdar.
Yeah, I am not able to see all the names here. So thank you, Diva. That was awesome. Great, great thought that pratikaman is a type of anupreksha. Of course, there's a bit different there, but I think you're right, largely. So now let's apply these five A's to our life, okay? We just covered all of them. I'm sure you knew about them a lot, but I want to make sure you have a good sense of that. So now let's talk about, remember, can someone give me all the five A's quickly? Anyone remembers all the five A's?
Guys,
you are all engaged. That's awesome. So you remember all the five. So these are like your tools, okay? Like you have tools in your toolbox. You have five tools. These five tools will help you all your life. Let's see how you can apply them, okay? So you have five tools. You have to tell which tool is being. So examples as I give, you have to tell me, are we violating one of the A's or are we following one of the A's, okay? And everything that is violated will come in red, and anything that is you are following will come in green. Always remember that. Let's see. Okay, here it is. So you find a $10 bill on a sidewalk. You look around and no one is watching. You bring it home and decide to buy a toy. What are you doing?
A churia.
Fantastic.
Churia.
Okay. Let's keep going now because this was an easy one. Let's take another one. Your friend Fred called another friend Jack a fat boy. You laughed. What was that?
Ahimsa.
Can you be more specific?
Ahimsa. Verbally.
Excellent.
Verbally ahimsa.
You violated ahimsa, the verbal ahimsa. Remember, this happens every day around us, right? Mm-hmm. How about this? You came back from a fun sleepover. Mm-hmm. Now you want to play a Fortnite game of Fortnite, right? Who likes Fortnite?
Aparigraha.
Okay. Oh, your mom did not let you do so. You were mad and you went into your room angry.
Ahimsa.
Aparigraha.
Yeah, no, you guys are so smart. It is interesting what you mentioned, aparigraha, because what you're doing is you're not satisfied with what you have already gotten. Excellent point, Adish. Anyone else? It is ahimsa. What kind of ahimsa?
It is ahimsa to yourself. Mentally.
Mind ahimsa.
Ahimsa of mind. Excellent.
Mentally.
Ahimsa to who? Yourself or your mom?
Yourself and your mom.
Excellent. It's ahimsa to both you, yourself, and to your mom. And I love the response on aparigraha also, because you're not satisfied with what you got. Although I did not capture aparigraha, that was the smart very smart point that was brought in. Anyone has any other comment? Okay, let's keep moving. Now this sun is also easy now, right?
Aparigraha.
Yeah.
Aparigraha.
Who likes more turquoise? All of you. Want more toys? More clothes? Right? Excuse me. All right. So you violated aparigraha. Now this is slightly interesting and a bit. So now imagine you have grown up and you have started working. Okay? I think most of you will start working in about 10 to 15 years, right? Maybe.
Acharya.
Acharya.
Very good. You already read it. So that's great.
Acharya.
Remember, I think this is a very interesting case. The company accidentally pays, so you grow up, you go to work, your company accidentally pays you twice the amount they owe you, right? Now you can decide to keep the money. They will never get to know about it. Okay? And whose mistake is this? Is this your mistake or their mistake?
Yours.
It's yours.
Both of them. It's both mistake.
Both of them's mistake.
Well, it started
both of them's mistake.
So a lot of people say, well, it's not my mistake. It's their mistake. I can just keep this money. Because it's their fault. They gave us, you know, you go to a store and the store clerk gives you more money than you should take. You will wonder, oh, you know what? Just take this money. Anyways, it was his mistake, not my mistake. How many times you go to a grocery store and they forget to check out something? And then suddenly you have a $10 thing that you never paid for. And so you're coming home and you're thinking, you know what? It was not my mistake. It was anyway their mistake. So why should I return it? Right? Isn't it? It happens sometimes in your mind that, oh, it's not my mistake. And I'll give another interesting example. You bought a new house, okay? Your parents bought a new house. You moved into the new house and you went into the bedroom and you found a big necklace of gold. What would you do? The old owner is gone. The house is yours. Is the necklace yours?
Try to contact the other person, and then if they don't pick up the phone, then give it to Don in the Dirasar, and there's a bandar, so put it in the bandar.
Very good, excellent, Veer.
So, and then ask for Maharshi for forgiveness.
Very nice. So just because the owner, yes, you're right, Veer. Just because the owner is not looking for something doesn't mean it belongs to you. Okay? So what you did is you violated Acharya. So let's go to the next one. Becomes easy that way. So you go to a park. Then you find a hungry and lost dog. You look around. You can't find the owner. You bring it home and feed it. What have you done?
Acharya.
Oh, but you did something good too. He's hungry.
But it might be from like the mom must have like left it so he can get some food. And since you're bringing it home, it won't know where it is now.
Yes, very good point. But I think so. Do you agree that since he was hungry, lost, for the owner, you couldn't find the owner, and then you brought the dog home? What did you do? You followed ahimsa. Right? You took care of the dog. Dog was hungry and lost and tired. You brought the dog home. Okay?
Someone else could have hurt the dog, so you did a good, right thing.
Yes, your dog would have gotten hurt, got left in the bushes. Maybe he would have died over there in cold winter, if you live in a winter cold place or in heat. So you did the right thing by bringing the dog home. But tell me about this. Now you love the dog so much that you decide to keep the dog.
That is a dog.
In Jainism, you're not supposed to keep it. So I think
So what you are doing is, now you are doing chori. Now you are violating acharya, because so you did not violate acharya when you brought home, gave it food, made the dog happy and took care of it and loved it. But what you should be doing, can anyone tell what you should do in this situation?
Then just put it back where you found it.
Or like
it can get lost again, my friend.
You can try to like find the owners.
Or put it in a dustbin.
Try and look around for the owners and see if there's a sign saying a lost dog.
Very nice. Excellent, excellent. So either you can look for a sign, or you can actually take the picture of the dog, post it on internet, or post it in your neighborhood applications, or just go and post it in the same park. Because remember, the owner may be looking for the dog pretty much every day. So one of these days, he will find the picture and he will call your phone number. So that's how you return stuff. You don't keep stuff that you find.
Or maybe the owner put his phone number on the dog, like collar.
That's a great point also. You should look at collar and see if there's a dog's contact information, owner's information is there, and that way you can return the dog back. But so the point I'm making is, sometimes you do right things, sometimes you do wrong things. And you need to know when you're doing right and when you're doing wrong in this case, right?
Sometimes.
Yes. Yes, Avni.
I have a question. So in the previous one, the one where they pay you twice, wouldn't that also be like aparigraha? Like you were violating it, you were being like greedy?
Absolutely. And you are 100% right, Avni. Usually, acharya vrat is preceded by parigraha. Or breaking of a chori. Chori, people do stealing because they are not happy with what they have, correct? So you're 100% right. That's a beautiful point you are making, Avni. Fantastic. I love the thought process. So usually you do stealing because you are not following a parigraha, because you want more stuff. Most of the time, not always. You could be hungry. Imagine this. You could be very poor and very hungry. You don't have anything, and now you want food, and you can steal food. Right? Is that the right thing to do? Anyone? Is it right thing to steal food if you're hungry?
No.
No.
Right. In no condition, it is a good thing to steal anything. In no condition. It's unconditional. If you want food, you ask someone saying, I'm hungry. I don't have money. Please give me food. Right? In no condition, you can steal. That's not a good idea. Now let's look at the next one. This happens all the time in families, right? You and your cousin had a fight. You don't talk to her anymore. Okay? Does that happen to you? Has it happened to you?
Ahimsa. Ahimsa verbally.
Ahimsa.
Very good.
Ahimsa.
Ahimsa verbally, and also from the mind, and also you might have a fight with your fist also. So
very good. It could be ahimsa of body also, violation of body also. What else? What causes the fight, guys?
Bad thoughts, maybe.
Verbally.
Yeah,
arguments.
What makes two people fight?
Arguments.
Maybe on a compound.
Very good. So why the fight happens is because you did not appreciate the other party's point of view. So the first thing what you did is you violated. Why occur? The fights don't occur for no reason. They occur because you don't agree with the other party. Hello? Is there a point here? Any comment? Okay. So why do people fight? Because what happens is, two people fight because first they violate anekantvad. They don't appreciate the other person's point of view. Right? And then what happens is, once they disagree with the other person, and then they start disrespecting verbally. Okay? When that happens verbally, what happens? physical fight occurs likely. So you become ahimsa, you create ahimsa of first voice, then body, and then you don't talk to her anymore. When you don't talk to someone anymore, what do?
Go to my room and sit down.
You do ahimsa, the third kind of ahimsa. Remember, when you don't talk to someone, you are still doing ahimsa with that person because you're thinking bad about them. You're thinking, well, Ashley is so bad, right? Or you're thinking, Jack is such a bad kid, I don't want to talk to him. So what you're doing is you're doing ahimsa of your mind. So imagine this, you have violated four rules by doing this. Anekantavad, ahimsa of voice or verbal, ahimsa of body potentially if you fight physically with nails or smack the other party. And then finally, because you're not talking to them forever, what is happening is that you're doing ahimsa of mind with them.
It can also be like if you're embarrassed to talk to them and you're doing introspection of how I acted and like.
That's a beautiful point. And I'm so glad you brought that up because that's what I have here. So after a few days and some thinking, you apologized and became friends again or cousins again and started playing or started meeting them. So now what you have done?
We followed Anekantvad and Ahimsa.
Beautiful. You re-followed. So you again followed. Okay, by the way, sorry. I think you also followed Anupreksha, correct? Think about it. You thought about this. You observed yourself. You realized that what your fault is, correct? So you first observed yourself. You realize that you've done, you did some deep thinking. Remember, what is Anupreksha? Anupreksha is the process of observing yourself from outside. So you observed what you did wrong. You realized it was your fault, or at least partially your fault. You went and apologized. I love someone said that it's also application of Anekantvad. So you followed first Anupreksha, then you did Anekantvad, and then finally you became friends again. So what did you do? You followed?
Ahimsa.
Ahimsa. Yeah.
When you are
from
Ahimsa, right? So do you guys find happens in real life, you end up fighting with people, you stop talking to them, and you feel bad about them. Sometimes you feel that, oh, this should not have happened. I just stopped playing with my cousin. Does that happen to anyone?
With your friends too.
It can happen with your friends.
It can happen with your siblings.
Siblings.
Yes.
All of you, look, there's nothing wrong in saying yes to it because I have done it. Preeti auntie has done it. Everyone has done it. We all have had fights where we have stopped talking to people.
I've done it.
Yes. Good. So you learn from your mistakes. You learn how to apply the 5 A's. Remember, 5 A's is a toolbox that you can apply every day in your life. Right? So now, this one is now easy. You guys are all much smart at it. So your parents are out. You accidentally broke a decorative piece, like this vase, okay? What you did is, the vase had a hole in it. You just turned it around, okay?
And
very good, okay?
Choria.
You decided to not tell your mom. Very good, you guys are just so smart. You're ahead of me on this one. So what is going on here? What A of Jainism is being violated?
Chorya.
Very nice. It's Asatya and Achorya both. I heard both of two people give fantastic answer to that. Remember, Asatya is a kind of a chori because you are keeping someone away from the truth. It's a kind of a stealing. When you don't tell the truth, you're keeping someone away from truth. And that means you are stealing the truth from that person. And hence, non-stealing and lying or non-lying are very are similar concepts. And
even
they both
never asked what anything happened. She never told her mom that happened. So that's still stealing or lying.
Oh, it is such a beautiful point Vyom has made. And I want you guys to think about this. Do any anupreksha on the point Vyom has made. Remember, asatya is not just not telling a lie. Asatya means telling what should be told. So your mom didn't come and say, what broke? Does your mom come home and says, what did you break today?
No.
They don't do that because you don't break every day. But remember, a lot of people think not telling the truth is asatya or achorya. Actually telling what should be told, but when you're not telling, is also violation of asatya or achorya. Do you understand this? That not telling the truth, even though you're not asked, is wrong. So your mom should have just gone to your mom and said, hey, you know, sorry, something happened. Even though you know she's going to be angry, you need to tell what is the truth and what they should know. So the point is, it is very important. Another thing, if you guys can spend a 30 second with me to think about this, that asatya and achorya are just derivatives of ahimsa. Does that make sense? Because if by not telling your mom what happened, by lying up about it, by hiding that information, you're breaking ahimsa. Because remember, she's going to be really sad when she gets to know about it. And the longer she waits to know about it, the more she's going to be angry and sad that you didn't tell her. So the point I'm making is asatya and achorya are derivatives of ahimsa. They're same as ahimsa. So what did you do? You violated achorya and ahimsa and asatya, all three, by not telling her that the thing broke. And so what you do is, again, you guys are already ahead of me. So after some thinking, you let her know and apologized. Now what did you do? Yes, Vyom. Go ahead, Vyom.
But then when her mom, when she tells her mom, then her mom might violate ahimsa, thinking, oh, why did my child do this?
Yes, that is such a great point you make, Vyom, that it is likely that when you come out clean, right? When you don't violate achorya or ahimsa, you end up getting hinsa back. So someone may be angry at you, someone may be unhappy with you, right? I think the way to look at it is, yes, that can happen, but the hinsa will be far more if she gets to know 15 days from, right? That's point number one. So you're going to be even more, she's going to be even more mad. Second thing is, because you went and told her, she would probably appreciate and take that into account before getting angry. And remember, your following of 5 A's has nothing to do with what others are doing. Okay? You should follow your 5 A's and you will realize others will start following your 5 A's. So it doesn't matter whether they are following or not, but when they see how you're following 5 A's, they also start following. Is that clear? So your great point, Vyom, that mom will be angry, she'll be upset, but I think you should still have the courage to tell her that I broke this. Okay, I'm going to, I think, take the last example here because we're running out of time pretty soon. This is my last example. In fact, before going to the last example, I want to tell you, sometimes real life is harder than this, okay? Sometimes what happens is no one answer is right. There are multiple answers that could be right. And so real life problems are far more different, right? Now, these are easy ones. You guys, of course, everyone was applying and doing a phenomenal job here. So let me show you an example where it's not easy to decide. And then I want you to think about this, okay? This is something that is given in Jainism as an example of a complex, relatively complex issue, right? Right? I will give you 30 seconds to read this. Everyone just read this carefully. You are in the woods. A hunter, you see a hunter chasing a deer. He's going to kill it, right? As you can see, he's aiming at the deer. And he fires at the deer and deer runs away. Luckily, deer gets saved. You see all this happening in front of your eyes because you're right there. Deer runs away. You look around. The hunter comes running and says, have you seen where the deer went? Now you have many choices at this point.
You say that you can find it yourself. I do.
Yeah, that is
you can find it yourself.
You should just say nothing also. Just don't say anything.
Why you can say the wrong thing because you're saving a deer.
Okay.
You don't know.
You can say that you can find it yourself.
Okay. Very good answer. Very good answers right now. Go ahead, Vyom.
Not saying anything is also a way of doing acharya, but even if you lie to the hunter saying that the deer went this way, even though it went that way, then it's either lying or it's either possibly saving a life. So
that's very good.
What if you lie and save a life? That's even more better than just killing someone and not lying.
But then not saying the full truth is also considered acharya or asatya. So
yeah.
You're gonna be committing a pap either way.
Well, you're gonna commit a bigger pap while saying the real one.
Yeah, you guys.
But what if we just don't get pap at all? Like, just don't say anything.
Don't say where the deer went.
Yes.
Yeah, but then if they go like, let's just say it was left and right, what if they start going left? And then
guys, listen.
Stop them.
You all have amazing inputs on that. You're right, it's a difficult problem, right? If you don't say anything, there is a chance that hunter can go in the right direction. If you give wrong direction to hunter. So these are the four choices. Actually, there's a fifth choice also. Let's see. Let's put all the choices in front of us. Okay. The first thing is you just tell the truth where the hunter went. Because remember, you've been told to always tell the truth by Jainism. Right? Because you don't want to do acharya or ahimsa or whatever. Asatya. Right? So you will tell the truth. Is that a good thing?
But you should only say the truth in some ways. Like, are you going to tell, like, the truth that someone's, like 100 pounds and you say, he's 100 pounds, he's 100 pounds. That's saying the truth, but it's in the wrong way, so.
Yeah. So, that's a great point you made is, you try to delay the conversation. Is that what you're saying? Just delay this and then finally say, yeah, he went east. Now, by that time, the deer is in safe territory. He has run away and very unlikely that the hunter will find the deer, correct? So now you're telling the truth, but you're telling it so late that deer got a chance to escape, correct?
I wasn't gonna say that, but I'm just saying that you can't say the truth in every situation.
Yes. I apologize. We're running out of time, so I'll just be quick here. So the second option is, you will say nothing. A lot of people said that. So you can act like dumb and deaf and even blind. You can say, I'm blind. I can't see where the deer went, right? I'm so sorry.
But that's lying.
That's a very good point. That's lying. So you could lie and save the life of the deer.
You can find it yourself.
Kian has a very good idea. Kian's point is that you should say I won't tell you. Okay? If you are even better at it, you can sit down and start explaining to him why you won't tell him, because you will believe in ahimsa and non-violence and so on, and maybe try to make him into a good person. Correct?
But then another question is, if the hunter will say, like, oh, like, you won't believe your point of view, so he'll violate on a gunpoint, and then instead of trying to find the deer, and he'll shoot you.
Good point.
What if you tell him, I won't tell you because that's against ahimsa, and he might also agree that, okay, I think I should not kill the deer.
Yeah, that is.
But there's a chance that he won't agree and get mad at you and kill you.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying.
So that is very likely that he may get angry at you, and then I'm going to shoot you. Mehul bhai. Okay, great. Thank you. I think there's a lot of noise here. So, guys, look, this is what the example of real life is complicated, right? And I think you can think of lots of scenarios. But one thing I can tell you is, always do what is right to save that deer's life, including lying is okay, right? Because your bigger cause, your bigger goal, bigger purpose in life at that point was to save the life of that deer. Of course, you don't want to lie. First thing you should do, hey, I'm not going to tell you, right? He's going to say, why you're not telling? You say, I believe in ahimsa, non-violence. He shows you a gun. You can say, look, that you're not being fair and nice to me. And then you can lie. You can say, hey, he went west, right? Because you're trying to save your life. Remember, hinsa against yourself is also bad. So you don't want to kill yourself in the process. So you say, the deer went in this direction. But net, you need to save that deer's life. That's what the goal of ahimsa is. So...
Maybe you can make his time go by and say, and start talking to him and say, hey, you're a good man, and yeah, and then give the deer to run away far away so the hunter can't go, and then tell him the real
deal. But then he will just get mad, right?
Guys, look, all the students, you guys have been absolutely amazing in brainstorming with me. The five A's, and I think you're really good at applying it now. I think you should apply it every day in your school and so on. We're running out of time, so I want to take you to my last slide here. And really, I hope you got some examples from real life. Think of more. Let us know if you find more examples of five A's in life. But so real life will present many difficult situations at your school, in college, at work, as you grow up, in your family, your relations, your wife, your husband. Always remember the five A's. And if you apply, you'll have the answers to your problems. And hence, you will live a very happy and peaceful life. So I would really encourage you guys to think about this. Share examples with us. You can send it to JVB email ID if you think about good examples. And you guys have been an amazing, amazing participant, student, audience for this presentation. So I want to thank you. I learned a lot from you. Not just I talked about it, but you guys are far ahead. And thank you to Shamini Ji. Thank you to JVB. Thank you to everyone that has been teaching you. So thank you. Thank you. Over to you, Mehul Bhai.
Thank you. Thank you, Kinesh Bhai. That was really very insightful application of the Jainism principles to the life. And I hope kids learned something out of this and they can apply it in their daily lives. Very good practical examples, very thought-provoking, interactive session. Really appreciate it. Thank you very much, Kinesh Bhai. I would say if you can all start your video for a moment and I can take a picture with Kinesh Bhai, it would be nice. Rashi, Danny, Dhairya, Raina, sin. Prasham. Right. Smile. All right, I think I got it. Let me just make sure that I have it before I let you go. Just 1 minute. Okay. All right, I got it. Okay, thank you very much. Samni ji, Mangal Paath sunayenge, aapko kuch bolna hai?
Uncle, Samni ji is not here yet.
Yeah, it looks like that way. Let me see. Yeah, we need to hear the Mangal Paath. Let me see.
I see JVP Orlando there.
Yeah, no, she's here, yeah, but...
But they might not be like... They might have just kept the laptop on and...
Yeah, it's possible.
Excuse me?
Mm-hmm.
Can I revise all the 5 A's?
Yes, that would be a great idea. Go ahead, please, Jinal. All the 5 A's.
Upper jigger, anikant bat. Upper jigger, anikant bat.
Achorya.
Achorya.
Ahimsa.
Ahimsa.
That's great. Great, guys. You got that right. And thank you again for listening. And, you know, you've been amazing. So just keep applying this and you'll have... You'll really enjoy your life.
What was the introspection name?
It was Anupreksha.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I tried to contact Samni ji, but for some reason... she's not picking up the phone. Maybe she's busy with the other session in other group. Anyway, I just wanted to let you know that we will have a test next Saturday. Next Saturday is our last session of this camp, summer camp series. We'll have one lecture and then we'll have a test, which would the test would be based on all the sessions you have attended so far. And then everybody will be given the certificate, whoever has successfully completed the camp.
What happens if we get the questions right?
Well, there will be like a passing grade, and if you pass it, then you know you'll be given a certificate. And I was also told that the top three scorers in the test would also be given prizes.
Mangal Paath sunaye
kachwa? Samni ji, acha Samni ji, aap Mangal Paath sunaye? Aapko kuch bolna hai Samni ji?
Nahi, Mangal Paath
bas. Acha Mangal Paath.
Okay. Chattari Mangalam Ananta Mangalam Siddha Mangalam Sahu Mangalam Keli Panatto Dhamo Mangalam Chattari Luktama Ananta Luktama Siddha Luktama
Vandami Namah Swami Samni Ji.